unit fractions and their infinite series and such ideas are not known even today. That is, people have not attempted, not cared to see whether a trigonometric sine function has a very good rational function approximation or not. But this was available in Bhaskaracharya's book. Translation of this passage by a well-known author, Dr. Shukla. Now I briefly state the rule without making use of the R sign differences 225, etc. This 225, etc. refers to the sign table of Aryabhata. We don't require it. That is an easier method. Subtract the degrees of a bhuja or koti. Bhuja and koti are the two sides of a right-angle triangle. From the degrees of half circle, then multiply the remainder by the degrees of bhuja or koti and put down the result at two places, one for the numerator and one for the denominator. At one place, subtract the result from 40,500. By 1/4 of the remainder thus obtained, divide the result at the other place as multiplied by the antyaphala, that is the epicyclic radius. Thus is obtained the entire bahu phala. Finally, the summary is, I am having a rational function which is very close approximation to the sine function, as we will see in the next slide. Even more audacious was Bhaskara's method. Here it is written Bhaskara I's method, because there were many Bhaskaras, for computing the sine using no geometry whatsoever. Just some coefficients of the polynomials are thrown, you can compute it. This is taken from, this quote is taken from the book, The Mathematics of the Heavens and the Earth. There is a popular website called MacTutor History of Mathematics. There it is written, the formula which Bhaskara gives is amazingly accurate, and use of the formula leads to a maximum error of less than 1%. The sample 5 is taken from Brahmagupta's Brahmasphuta Siddhantam. It gives a formula for the diagonals of a cyclic quadrilateral if the four sides A, B, C, D are known. As shown here, one diagonal will be square root of AD plus BC into AC plus BD divided by AB plus CD. Another diagonal will be the square root of a similar expression with small changes here. The way in which it is expressed, sometimes I speak at length about this also. Without these symbols, how were they able to express the formulas? AD plus BC into AC plus BD, how do we express it just in a verse like this? It says, the sums and the products of the sides about the diagonals be both divided by each other. I think it is not following this closely. I will better not read it and go directly to this. Karnashrita bhuja ghataihi. Bhuja means sides, ghata means product, karna means diagonal. There are two diagonals. If you give one diagonal, take the bhuja which pertain to that diagonal and multiply them. Sorry. I am reading the third line. Yogena bhuja prati bhuja. Bhuja means side, prati bhuja means opposite side. Vadhayoho means product. You take a side and its opposite side, then take the product. Then yogena means after taking the product, yoga means addition. Then you will get karna, the two diagonals. That is the way in which this formula is written in the same Arya meter, so that it is easy to remember. While writing about this formula, a contemporary historian of ours writes, I took it from our library book in our university, most remarkable in Hindu geometry and solitary in its excellence about this formula. This is H. Eaves. Book title is An Introduction to History of Mathematics, published in 1969. Similar was the appreciation of this result a century ago, taken from another history of mathematics book. Remarkable is Brahmagupta's theorem on cyclic quadrilaterals diagonals. Author is Cajori. Book title is History of Mathematics, and this is about Cajori, Switzerland citizen. He is an author of a widely acclaimed text on the history of mathematics, and this is his book. I pass on to the sixth sample. This pertains to astronomy. This shloka is taken from one Lallacharya's book. Book was published by INSA, Indian National Science Academy, Delhi. It defines certain periods of time. These are called yogas. Nowadays in Indian calendars there will be 5 parts. It is why it is called Panchangam. Among the 5 parts, the 4th and the 5th are yoga and karana. For yoga, there are many yogas like Vishkambha, Preeti and so on. 2 of the yogas are defined here, Vaidhrita and Vyatipata. This Vyatipata, etc., are very much related to the religious ritual timings also. Sir William Wilson Hunter, in his book The Indian Empire, writes, even more India has done in mathematics for algebra, geometry, astronomy, and the triumph of modern science. These were discovered in India and in reality in Sanskrit words. This passage is using astronomy, the position of the moon, to define Vyatipata yoga. Sample 7 is taken from Vatasheri Parameshwara's book. Book title is Leelavati Vyakhyanam, commentary on Leelavati. Doshnam dvayor dvayor ghata. Doshnam means for the sides. Dvayor dvayoh means taken 2 at a time. Ghata means product. Here we are seeing AB, CD, AC, BD. These are product of sides taken 2 at a time. Then yutinam, yuti means adding. AB plus CD is one expression, AC plus BD is another expression, AD plus BC is another expression, and so on. Tisrinam vadhe. Tisrinam means take 3 such expressions. Vadhe means take the product of them. AB plus CD into AC plus BD into AD plus BC. This is the way in which he expresses it in words. This is for what? This is for finding the circumradius of this quadrilateral. In other words, the radius of the circle circumscribing this quadrilateral. I move on to the next. Ifra is a historian. He has written this sentence, but in a different context. The measure of genius of Indian civilization, to which we owe our modern system, is all the greater in that it was the only one in all history to have achieved this triumph. This applies to the previous formulae also. Sample 8 gives a formula for sum in an arithmetic progression. There are formulas for sum of n terms of an arithmetic progression. The one that is taken here is sum of the squares of the n terms of the arithmetic progression. This is taken from Mahaviracharya's book, Ganita Sara Sangraham, 9th century AD. At present, we learned this formula n into n plus 1 into 2 n plus 1 by 6 as the sum of the squares of the first n integers. That becomes a corollary to this formula. Mahaviracharya is a 9th century Jain mathematician from Mysore. He was the author of Ganita Sara Sangraha. Until his time, the textbook that was followed in India for several centuries was Brahma Sputta Siddhanta of Brahmagupta. After Mahavira in 9th century wrote his book Ganita Sara Sangraham, that superseded it, that became the textbook for mathematics for the students in India. A Nestorian bishop in 662 AD, he lived in Iraq, but the book says he lived in a place that is presently known as Iraq. He writes, of the science of the Indians, of their subtle discoveries in astronomy, discoveries that are more ingenious than those of the Greeks and the Babylonians, and of their valuable methods of calculation, which surpass description, the sentence is not complete. I have stopped that. My next sample is a formula for an infinite series. This actually gives a formula for an infinite series for the number pi. Vyase varidhi nihate and so on. This is taken from a book called Tantra Sangraham, 14th century. Ian Pierce writes in his website, the simplest fact is that many of the key results of mathematics, some of which are at the very core of modern day mathematics, they are of Indian origin. The results were almost all independently rediscovered by European scholars. To neglect facts is both ignorant and arrogant. He writes so harshly because there were historians before him, like S. Kaye and others, who took a lot of pains to discredit India. They were saying that, yes, this formula is found, but maybe there was a Greek influence. At that time, they may have learnt it from some other civilization and so on. That is why Pierce is writing, to neglect facts is both ignorant and arrogant. If it is sporadically in one book or two books, you may say that it is like that. It is a continuous tradition passing through so many centuries in the last 3 or 4 millennia. Sample 10 is taken from Varaha Mihira's Brihat Samhita, Purvena Purvena Gatena Yuktam. This gives a formula for N choose R that we study in combinations and permutations. Formula is factorial N divided by factorial R into factorial N minus R. This verse has been translated by one professor, S. Madhavan, who is a scholar both in Sanskrit and in mathematics. He translates it, write the numbers 1 to n in the direct order and in the reverse order below and retain only according to the requirement. The result is the formula. 1 into 2 into 3 into n R on one side. On the other side, it is n into n minus 1 into n minus 2. Same number of terms, one in the direct order, another in the reverse order. It's the same formula. It is an old copy of this book. I have not seen it reprinted recently. This is about the book itself. This book is not just a mathematics book. It includes astrology, planetary movements, eclipses, rainfall, clouds, architecture, growth of crops, that is agriculture, manufacture of perfume, matrimony, domestic relations, gems, pearls, and rituals, and so on. Something like an encyclopedia. my next sample, I may not be able to complete everything, but I will stop after, say, two more. This, unlike the previous passages, is only in prose, it is not in poetry. Uparishtati ekam chaturashra koshtam likhitva. I found this book in a library at Ernakulam in Chinmaya library. Then I copied this passage from Halayudha's book, 10th century AD. This is not in poetry because this is not an original book, this is only a commentary on another book. This is taken from the commentary. Translation: draw a square box on the top. Below that, draw two boxes projecting out on both sides. Below that, three. Below that, four. And so on, up to as many rows as we want. This is Meru Prastara. In its first box, keep the number one. Fill up the other boxes as per the instructions being given now. I have not written the remaining things here in this slide. This is how to write up what we now call as Pascal's triangle. That is described, the name given in the olden days is Meru Prastara. Once I was talking about it to another August audience, where one Russian professor was sitting in the first row. He said that the word prastara for expansion is there in Russian language also. Same prastara means expansion. This is for binomial expansion in Sanskrit. Dr. Donald Knuth, who has written very popular books, The Art of Programming and also on Fundamentals of Algorithms, whose books are prescribed as textbooks in our computer science departments. Nowadays, there are newer books, but for more than 20 years, all our students and all students in other countries of the world were also reading his books as textbooks. In that, such a popular book he has written, the binomial coefficients have a long and interesting history. The earliest known appearance of binomial coefficients is in a 10th century commentary due to Halayudha, part of which we just now read, on an ancient Hindu classic, the Chandas Sutra. In about 1150, the Hindu mathematician Bhaskaracharya gave a very clear exposition of binomial coefficients in his book Leelavati, section 6, chapter 4. Therefore, the history of this part, combinatorics, is very well recorded. This is from yet another book. We are all familiar, we are taught in the 9th class in our school how to solve a quadratic equation. There is a formula for the roots of a quadratic equation in terms of the coefficients. We use square root of b square minus 4ac, call it the discriminant, and use it to describe the roots. That formula is available in Sridharacharya's book, and nowadays NCERT books have included this history also. Therefore, our students know that it is an Indian contribution. Chaturahata varga samaihi rupaihi pakshadvayam gunayet. The Indian scholars enabled the rapid development of algebra, referring to this, the book The Universal History of Numbers. Sample 13, a shloka of second Bhaskaracharya. Second Bhaskaracharya was more a poet than a mathematician. He uses several kinds of meters. This one is Vritta Kshetre Paridhi Gunita Vyasapada Phalam Yati. Meter is similar to Kalidasa's Megha Sandesha meter. Meter is called Mandakranta. He uses several other similar meters to sing verses. Mathematical formulas will be sung as poems. In a circle, the circumference multiplied by 1/4 of the diameter is the area. which multiplied by 4 is its surface area going round it like a net round a ball, surface area of the sphere. This surface area multiplied by the diameter and divided by 6 is the volume inside sphere. Exactly the same formula that we know, 4 by 3 pi r cube. This is how he puts it. This is from a book called Yukti Bhasha. This book was originally written in Malayalam language in Kerala School of Mathematics, but later translated into Sanskrit also. But the passage given here from that book is actually a Sanskrit passage. This author, Yukti Bhasha, author says that his teacher's name is Madhavacharya of Sangama Gramam, is the Sanskrit name for the town. The present name in Kerala is Irinyalakuda. In Irinyalakuda, his teacher gave this formula. His teacher's work is lost because this formula is recorded in the pupil's book. It is surviving now. One should multiply the arc and the resulting products by the square of the arc, and these should be divided in order by the squares of the even numbers, combined with the roots and multiplied by the square of the radius. What is this for? I took this translation from a book by T.A. Saraswati Amma. This is for finding an infinite series. Nowadays we know it as Taylor-Maclaurin series. Can we? I see. No, that doesn't matter. We are already near the end of the lecture. There were only 16 samples taken. I'm willing to stop with the 14th sample. And now I'm giving a summary. The summary is, I have taken 16 samples from 16 different books, just only to see that there is so much of variety there. There are about 100 books of Sanskrit available, printed also. And there are many others which may be lying in Oriental Manuscripts Library without seeing the print also. How do I say that? One professor, David Pingree, he has taken a census of books in science available in Oriental Manuscripts Library. That list gives several other books. Of course, I should also add that list includes some useless books also. Most of the books may not be worth printing also. Whatever is available in the library has taken the census, but some of them may be very important books which are yet to be printed. The summary is, so much of wealth is available. The best thing to preserve that wealth is, many, many more of us should learn that language, Sanskrit. We have been learning one kind of education. Suddenly, the type of education has changed, and we have forgotten all our previous tradition. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Vikanen. We'll take some questions.
Thank you. Very good presentation. I'm quite happy. I met Pingree, you know, I was in the States and I met David Pingree. We discussed some of the issues also that he had little not clarity about. There is another book. The title of the book is Lost Discoveries.
Lost Discoveries.
Have you seen that book? By Dick Teresi.
Yes, I have seen. They have purchased it for our library. In another presentation, I have quoted from that book also.
It was published in 2005. Let me give you a little idea how it happened. The Dick Teresi, he found that Indians and Chinese and some other nation, you know, people are writing that they knew so much in the past and Europeans did not know, that kind of a thing, you know. And he said, look, people are trying to unnecessarily bring down the contributions of Europe, and therefore he will write and respond that no, the others did not do much, there are very little, they are just highlighting it. So he started research. And when he went to research, this is written in the preface of the book. And when ultimately he is entered into research, he produced this book saying that the people are not saying enough. The Indians are not saying enough about the researches that are available in the past. The Chinese are not saying enough. And he covered much more than anybody had covered. Maybe you would like to read that. And it goes beyond mathematics. It's not confined to mathematics. It takes up other things also. I have read the book. I had a copy of it. So you may consider. The other thing is that whatever collections you have done, if you make a collection and pass it on to me, I will give you my address.
Yes,
I will get it published under your name.
Thank you. Okay. I'll take your address.
Sir, it is just wonderful, presentation. I have one question. I mean, asked to earlier, like Professor Ramasubramaniam from IIT Bombay and others, but not got very satisfactory answer. Usually what we do, if we say that A plus B whole square is equal to A square plus 2AB plus, B square, we write it in this way. Now, it's also a very simple and elegant way to write. But why this kind of way of expressions were not adopted in the Indian mathematics? I mean, or why they were not having this kind of expression, like the way we write, and instead in the shloka form, actually.
Okay, I'll try to answer that question. It is true that symbols were not used in expressing formulas. There may be two reasons for that. Why do we use symbols? Because it is an easy way to remember. But Sanskrit language has an inbuilt flexibility that what we write in symbols briefly can be written equally briefly in a shloka also. I will give an example. If you ask what is the area of a triangle with sides ABC, then we will say that it is square root of S into S minus A into S minus B into S minus C, where S equal to A plus B plus C by 2. In symbols, that is the way to write. How did Brahmagupta express it? He expressed it in a more brief way, even though there were no symbols. It may not be possible in other languages. His formula is Bhuja Yoga Ardha Chatushtaja Bhuja Vona Ghata. Over. Actually, if you count the space occupied or number of bits involved, Brahmagupta shloka is shorter than this formula. Because he doesn't even introduce another variable S equal to A plus B plus C by 2, but that is there. Bhuja yoga artha is that S. Bhuja means sides, yoga means sum, artha means half. Bhuja yoga artha means semi-perimeter. Therefore, that comes, without symbols it comes. Why should I introduce a symbol S, then say that it is called semi-perimeter, then say S minus A, S minus B. Bhuja una chatushtaja bhuja una. You have to subtract one side after the other. S minus A, S minus B, S minus C, S minus D. They are chatushtaja bhuja una. Ghata you have to multiply. Pada you have to take square root. Over. The formula is written more easily. And because it is in a poem form, it is easy to sing it. The other formula we cannot sing. This can be just sung as a song. Many of the formulas of Aryabhatta, Brahmagupta, etc., they were songs, not only memorized, but sung also by students. Therefore, it registers in the heart more easily. That may be one of the reasons.
So, can I take one more question here?
Yes, please.
Sir, whatever they are written in the Sanskrit, but they don't give the proof of that. Means my question is, there is an ancient India in. They are looking at the mathematics in that way, or they don't know the proof. And another question is, means there are Ramanujan, many problem statements about the Ramanujan, Madhava everywhere, but they are not curious about the proving the statements. Means they have like put in that all the statements in the book. And if the European mathematician